This presentation is devoted to the analysis of natural phenomena and some features of the behavior of many heterogeneous materials containing microcracks, pores, inclusions, lymphoid elements, and other heterogeneities of structure. It's well known that the behavior of heterogeneities depend on the type of external forces. There are many mechanisms for deformation of heterogeneous materials, and I have not enough time to tell about all of them, but only about the microscopic behavior of these materials and some features of their behavior. Some of these features are the following. There is no single curve of the dependence between effective stress and effective strain. The effective stress and curves depend on loading conditions. Shear stresses may cause the volumetric deformation. Shear strains and bulk strain are interrelated to these materials. Under conditions when the hydrostatic combined of stress is compressive one, material dilatation can take place. I can show some results of experimental studies demonstrate these features. Here you can see the effective stress strain curves obtained for structural graphite under proportional loading, and curve 1 corresponds to uniaxial tension, curve 2 to uniaxial compression, third to pure shear, and fourth to uniform biaxial tension. Here you can see the effective stress strain curves obtained for cast iron, and curve 1 corresponds to uniaxial tension, curve 3 to uniaxial compression, curve 3 to pure shear, but others were obtained under different ratios of main stresses. To characterize each of these curves, we can use this parameter, which is ratio of hydrostatic component of stress to the effective component of stress, named as stress triaxiality. Here you can see the effective stress strain diagrams obtained for limestone under conditions of reaxial compression by axial load and lateral pressure, with different ratios between these two loads. Curve 1 corresponds to reaxial compression, but others obtained under conditions of reaxial compression with the following values of this parameter of stress triaxiality, or the stress state type parameter. Here you can see the effective stress strain curves obtained for tech chloride under the same conditions, but we have more curves for this rock, and curve 1 corresponds to units of compression. 6 to and others were obtained under conditions of reaxial compression, and here you can see the porosity of it. And for white marble, we have similar set of effective stress strain curves. And instead of a single curve, we have a fan of curves, and the deviation between these effective stress strain curves is significant. To solve boundary value problems, including crack problems, we need to have corresponding constitutive relations. And for the solution of crack problems, constitutive relations of deformation theory can be used, and in this case we can formulate this complementary potential function, differentiating it with respect to the stresses. We obtain the following constitutive relations. They seem to be very complex, but they can be represented in more simple form when we use the power law function for the description of these curves. In this case, we have the following constitutive relations. In these relations, we have two functions, lambda and lambda capital. But these functions aren't independent, they are related. Here you can see the relation between these functions and their derivatives. And these functions have to satisfy some requirements when stress triaxiality approaches cases of values of plus or minus infinity, or in the cases of uniform three-axial tension and uniform three-axial compression. Using these constitutive relations, we can obtain the relation between effective strain and effective stress, and between bulk strain and hydrostatic component of stress. And as you can see, there is a relation between bulk strain and effective strain. Here you can see the graphs of this function determined for chloride, limestone, and marble. As soon as this function is determined, the second function can be determined too with the use of this simple relation. And it's very interesting to analyze the dependence between the bulk strain and the hydrostatic component of stress. We can, as soon as we determine all the necessary function, material functions, we can obtain the theoretical dependencies between these values. And the theoretical results are shown by solid lines, and here you can see the experimental values for these two, three types of rock, and you can see the correspondence between theoretical curves and experimental data is quite satisfactory. And I have to turn your attention that you can see here curves 1 correspond to uniaxial compression, and we can see that hydrostatic component of stress and bulk strain can have different signs, and this is most pronounced for white marble. Here you can see the function obtained for function lambda, obtained for graphs of function lambda, obtained for graphite, AR wing graphite, and cast iron. And you can see here the analytical representation for this function describing this experimental data, and you can see here the values of parameters for this two materials. And for rocks, all the parameters were determined too. And when we solve boundary value problem, we must be confident that we obtain reliable results. So you can see here the conditions for the solution of boundary value problem. They seem to be very complex, but they must be checked in any case when we solve the boundary value problems for some particular functions, lambda and lambda capital. And now some words about the solution of drug problems. I confine myself to the consideration because of the lack of time. Conditions of plane stress. In this case, we have the system of equilibrium equations and compatibility equation, and we can use to solve this problem stress function. And to obtain analytical representations for stresses, strains, and displacements, we neglect the linear part of strain in comparison with nonlinear one. And in this case, we have the following constitutive relations. And when we obtain this equation for stress function, very nice equation, and then similar part of the solution near the cryptic can be represented in this form. The exponent depends on the exponent of nonlinearity of stress strain curves. And in this case, the stress that triaxiality parameter is a zero order function of stresses. And it means that it is only a function of power law. This simplifies the solution of crack problems significantly. Here you can see the presentations for stresses, strains, and displacement. And you can see here the results of calculations performed for these curves we obtained for cast iron and graphite. And in comparison, you can see here the stress field near crack tip if we use the assumption of plastic incompressibility. And you can see that values of stresses is lower in comparison with incompressible material, and nonlinear stress intensity factor is lower too, particularly for these two materials. And for rocks we obtained similar results. And here you can see the field, strain field near the crack tip for plastically compressible material and plastically incompressible material. And we have another effect, the strains are larger in comparison with incompressible material. And you can see here the stress strain selectivity. The triaxiality parameter changed significantly near the crack tip. And I would like to turn your attention to the complexity of the solution of crack problems for heterogeneous materials. Because the stress state parameter near the crack tip is not constant. It means that the material properties depend on the stress state type and changes from point to point. And we have to take into account this complementary heterogeneity of material properties. And another effect, along which ray originated from the crack tip, this parameter is constant, but it has different values for different rays. And it means that primary isotropic material becomes an anisotropic one. And these effects were taken into account when we solved the crack problems. Thank you for your attention.